We shall see the framework of the program evaluation now. The framework for program evaluation is nothing but it talks about the steps in the program evaluation study. So, while we'll go through these stages or the various steps in the framework, you would remember the various stages of conducting any research. But here they are once again made very specific to the type of research that is taken up, which is the program evaluation. So, we shall see the steps one by one. First one is the engaging stakeholders. So, before the program evaluation is taken up, the stakeholders, that is the people for whom the program evaluation and its findings are going to be important, they are well informed about the such kind of study being conducted. One cannot keep them in dark and then conduct the study. So, they should be well aware of what is happening. The second one is the describing the program. So, exactly what the program is at present, how is it being conducted, what are the salient features of this program, what are the maybe some unique characteristics, what are some unique learning experiences that are given to the students and so on. All that is described in detail as a background. Focusing the evaluation design. Now, we have seen the three program evaluation designs, out of which one of the three is the best suitable for the program that is being evaluated is decided, of course, along with the rationale for the choice made. Gathering credible evidence. So, as we have seen that the kind of resources that are used, the kind of data that is used, the kind of instruments that are used for collecting data, that all this is detailed out and it is ensured that the creditable data is collected at the end of it. The data which can be authentic, the data on the basis of which the findings can be made, which can be generalized for that particular program. Then justifying the conclusions. After the data analysis, the conclusions are drawn and one justifies the conclusions in the sense that this is a discussion of the conclusions. Suppose a particular practice in the program evaluation is successful, then why is it so much liked by the industry or by the world of work? That could be analyzed. Or even the other way around, that if the industry says that this particular candidates of yours we take up for because they have say research skills, then the program evaluator goes back and sees, connects this data with the actual experiences that are given during the program for development of research skills. So, this kind of justifications are helpful so that the people who are conceiving the program, they get lot of inputs through the findings. Ensure, use and share lessons learned. Now, this is once again very important stage, the last one though, because the lessons that are learned through this could be useful for other programs, could be useful for the other organizations as well. If a particular kind of people or a particular skill set is needed by the world of work, then maybe the educational institutions or universities can focus upon having those skills developed in their students, and then accordingly the coursework can be designed for the students. So, thus from this framework we can see that it is a very systematic study and goes into a very scientific way, and the program evaluation does give the important conclusions that are useful for not only the people who are designing the program, but maybe at times even for the people who are from the world of work. We have discussed a lot about the program evaluation studies. Now we shall move on to the third type of evaluation studies, that is the follow-up studies. The word follow-up is very much familiar to us. Many a times we have used or we have heard this word in context of medical treatment. Take a simple example that suppose a person goes through operation, bypass surgery. So, it's not only that after the surgery, say for 2-3 days the person is under observation in the hospital and after that the person is discharged from the hospital and is sent home. The confidence that the doctors have at this stage is not sufficient that the person is living a healthy life thereafter. But the person, that patient is called for checking after every, say, 6 months and a year and so on. And these checkups, which are maybe after a longer duration after this surgery, bypass surgery, they are called as the follow-ups checkups. So once again, his heart is checked, his various pathological tests are made and so on. So it is a serious and detailed study or detailed investigation that goes into after every periodical time after the surgery. And that gives the more confidence to the doctor that, okay, whatever operation was conducted, whatever measures were taken, they were not only useful for immediately after the operation, but even after 6 months, the heart is working properly. Say after a year, after 2 years, the heart has been working properly. That assurance is very much needed. This follow-up study not only gives this confidence to the doctors, but it also keeps detailed eye on any some other mishaps or any other physical complications that may crop up. Thus, the follow-up studies are useful in terms of the health of a person. Now, this was an example from the, say, clinical research point of view or from medical science. Similarly, even in the sociological researches or in the behavioral researches, such follow-up studies are necessary. And that is why follow-up studies are the types of evaluation studies. Now, as we had seen the example of clinical research where the person has given some physical treatment or some surgery, which is physical. In case of behavioral sciences, maybe the person may be given a treatment in terms of, say, some learning experiences are given in order to improve the conceptual clarity on a particular subject, or for improvement of, say, some skills in certain areas. And then the follow-up studies could be useful later on. Suppose person is given researching skills for 2 years during the master's degree, and even after, say, 1 year or after 5 years, 10 years, the follow-up is conducted with the students, now the ex-students, the alumni, that to what extent they are still having those research skills, to what extent are they useful for their world of work, or do they actually forget after a couple of years, or if they don't use it. So such kind of questions are addressed when follow-up studies are undertaken. Follow-up studies give lot of inputs for the program designers in terms of whether to have a particular component, whether to retain a particular component in the program or otherwise. And with the changing needs of the society, with the changing needs of the world of work, one can decide whether this particular component has any relevance or whether it needs to be replaced by something else. Another type of evaluation studies is the replication and the secondary analysis. As the name suggests, replication is conducting the same study once again. Maybe the same experiment is conducted once again, or maybe at times the survey is conducted once again. But the varying factors could be the situation could be different, the socio-economic conditions would be different, socio-cultural conditions could be different. We shall see the technical definition of the term. Replication study involves repeating a study using the same methods but with different subjects or experimenters. Now here, as the definition says, the objectives are exactly the same, but they are tested with some other group. The researcher is different, and even the subjects, the people on whom the study is being conducted or the replication study is being conducted, they are different. For example, suppose the learning through Moodle is useful and is found to be helpful for students in, say, metro city like Mumbai. Whether it was useful even for the group at a remote area, maybe in the northeast region of India. So in this case, the socio-cultural conditions are different, the languages spoken are different, the people would be different. So whether one is getting the same results across the various geographical areas is in the focus. So in the replication studies, something like this happens. Now, why does one take up the replication studies? What are the determinants the replication study. We shall see them. Replication study is conducted in order to be sure whether the study that was conducted earlier, whether it was valid and reliable. The replication study is conducted in order to assure that the results obtained, they are valid and reliable. So, if the person is getting the same results with the varying group of people or getting the same results at varying geographical locations, then one can say about the earlier research and the findings that they were valid and reliable. This kind of problem comes, or the situation comes, especially when one is, say, designing psychological tests. So, if initially the researcher develops the test and administers the test with a particular set of people having certain socio-cultural characteristics, socio-economic background, but whether it is having the same impact or whether it is giving the same results even with some other groups is always tested, in that case the replication studies are useful. The second purpose for which the replication studies are conducted is to determine the role of the extraneous variables. Now, the researchers are expected to list out, and they do list out, the extraneous variables, the other variables which played their role while the independent variable is having its impact on the dependent variable. But at times what happens is first researcher has enlisted some 5 extraneous variables. While studying these researches later, some other researcher comes across or thinks of some other extraneous variables as well, which maybe the earlier researcher has not given the thought to. In that case, what happens is the replication studies conducted of the exactly same research, and then the whether those additional extraneous variables are making any impact or whether they are having any impact and to what extent, it's studied during that particular research. Another purpose of having the replication study, in order to see whether the findings of the earlier researches, to what extent they are applicable to the new situations. This kind of objective could be all the more applicable for the researches that are related to the technology. Earlier it was only blackboard or chalkboard available to the teacher. As against that, today there are so many other resources available to both the teachers as well as to the students. So the situation is very much changed as compared to, say, what the situation was, say, maybe 20 years ago. So, one can check whether the findings that were obtained from the research that was conducted 20 years ago, whether the same findings are applicable today. That could be definitely checked. The mentality of the society is also being changed a lot with the lot of technological advancement. So, whether the findings earlier, they are still applicable today, that could be at times the concern or the matter of study for the researcher. At times there are earlier researches conducted maybe in the similar area, and one wants to compile those findings of those studies and then check them in the new situation or take up some new research on the basis of that. And the such kind of scope is obtained through the replication studies. Thus, we have seen that there could be many purposes or many different kinds of objectives because of which the researcher would take up the replication studies. Now, depending on what the focus is, the person would choose the new subjects, the new situations, and maybe even the new extraneous variables at times. What are the conditions when the replication studies are best suited to be carried out? We shall discuss some of them. When the original research question is so important that it has implications even for today, or it has the relevance even in the today's practices, then that is the situation where one needs to carry out the replication study. The existing policies and literature, they are having the implications the larger group of people or larger society, and it has the base of the earlier researches. Then one needs to carry out the replication studies in order to check whether that base is still the same or whether the social reality has changed over a period of time. Another requirement for replication studies is the researcher or the team of researchers, they do have the same level of expertise as well as access to the sources, access to those population samples from whom the data needs to be collected. If that access is not there, or if there are challenges in having the same access, then it will not be appropriate to compare the results that are obtained in the earlier study, the results that are being obtained in the present study. Another major consideration while taking up a replication study is checking the possibility of having the same rigor as in the earlier study. If the rigor is different, then once again you cannot compare the results of the both the studies. Thus, there are certain situations, unique situations under which one should take up the replication studies, and it would make more sense in having the study all over again with the new situation, with the new groups, and then compare the results with the earlier ones. One more aspect which we are noting from this discussion about replication studies is, unlike other studies, they would speak about earlier researches. Every research takes up something called as review of related researches. And the researcher at the end of the research do discuss his findings with those of the earlier ones, yes. But in case of the replication studies, this is very, very much mandatory. And not only that, but since the exact study is being replicated, the exact study is being carried out once again, this comparison goes to a much, much micro level. And every aspect, every finding from the new study can be compared with those in the earlier researches. One more example I would like to share when we talk of a replication studies. In an organization or in an university, ICT was being used for the admission purposes. Now, earlier it was offline process, and then it was at one point it was online process started. This process began at the stage where the words like website, email ID were not so much known to the common people. So it was an experience where the people would ask the questions like, where can you buy website? Where is the cyber cafe? I don't have any cyber cafe nearby, and so on. Now the research was conducted regarding the problems that are faced by the students while accessing this ICT facilities for the admission. Same research is still being conducted over a period of time of say 8 years, 10 years. And now over a period of time, you can see so much change in the mentality of the students. Earlier it was like the students wouldn't know that what is the website and how to access it. Even the instructions to be given at that time were, it wouldn't be sufficient that suppose there is a link given for the people who are selected for the first round of interview. The institution was required to write, if you want to see the list of the candidates selected for the first round, then you click here. So it was a whole sentence that was written, which is completely against the theory of say web designing. But gradually it was not needed that this whole sentence is required. Gradually it was very much that even if you write just the two words, that list of selected candidates for first interview, and give a hyperlink to it, they would reach the actual list. It was against the force from the students that they would ask that, like, instead of asking us to pay the fees offline in cash or in demand draft, why don't you make the online facility available? This kind of experiences were gathered face to face. Apart from that, these replication studies were every year conducted at the time of admission. And this has helped that organization to a great extent in finalizing the policies for further decisions. One small aspect I would like to give here. For example, earlier they were giving the admission letters through the post. The post office was used for sending the admission letters. At one point it was thought that it will be a good idea if we send them SMS that your interview is and so on so date, and you please check the website. Now, in order to take this decision, about the mobile number, and it was found that year that it was 99.99% of the applicants had given the mobile numbers, so the institution could very safely take the decision of not sending the letters by post and send just the SMS of the. So this is an example of how the replication studies are helpful in the over a period of time. Another type of evaluation study is the secondary analysis. Now here, as the name suggests, secondary analysis. So for secondary to appear, there is something already primary. So primary analysis is the data is collected afresh and it is analyzed afresh first time it is being analyzed and the conclusions are drawn. Now secondary analysis means conduct using the same data. Here the data is not changed, like as we have seen in the replication studies, data is once again collected with a new set of people. But here the data is not collected once again, the data, ready-made data is used, but the analysis modalities are different, the angles of analysis are varied, and then same data is analyzed in the using the different modalities. Here the purpose of analyzing the data is different than the purpose at the time of primary analysis. So here the purpose may be varying than the original one. Secondary analysis is very widely used in case of the quantitative researches, but in qualitative researches it is not so much used. The very reason could be in quantitative researches, the once the data is collected, that is the fact at that time. But in case of qualitative researches, even the data that is gathered is through the angle of or through the eyes of that particular researcher. If the moment the researcher changes, the data may be different. The same facts would look differently for the different researcher. And maybe that is the reason because of which the secondary analysis is not conducted so much in case of qualitative studies as it is being widely used in case of quantitative studies. While conducting the secondary analysis, there are some ethical issues. The person who is conducting the secondary analysis is not the part of the team who has collected the data originally. So one has to look at that data from that limited lens or limited perception, and in that case, the right from the availability of the data, there are issues till the like the way the data is looked at by this next researcher. Actual utility of this secondary analysis is also in focus while taking up this kind of a research. That just because the data is available and just because there could be different angles of analysis of that data, that does not give sufficient background or does not give sufficient reason for taking up the secondary analysis. But the actual conduction of the secondary analysis, whether it is adding any new dimensions, whether there is really any value addition to the facts that are being generated through it, that are into focus while taking up the secondary analysis. The efforts are worth only if the another kind of analysis is going to add some new angle to it, throw some different lights to the actual data, and it has all the more important is it has some relevance in today's life or today's society. Only then it is worth spending that much time, energy and money for conducting the secondary analysis. We have seen four major types of evaluation studies, and we have seen that how they are differ in their focus, how they differ in the purpose and the context. As the evaluation studies have the implication not only in the social research but in various kind of disciplines. Through the examples also it is very clear to us. So all the various disciplines, they do have the utility of this evaluation studies. Now depending on the focus of one's study, depending on the discipline and depending on the data, the of that particular effort in today's era, today's society, then the researcher should take a decision which of the four types one should be using for one's own research.